Dear students, now let us take the second part of the comparative account of respiration, respiratory organs rather. In the previous lectures, we have discussed the comparative account of gills. Now it is the turn of the lungs. Now, today, gills were the essential respiratory organs of the aquatic animals, whereas lungs are the essential respiratory organs of land vertebrates and some lung fishes. Jewett was a scientist who believes that lungs are derived from the last pair of gill pouch, which do not open to the exterior through gill slits. So he has taken in account of evolution of the lungs. So he proposed this, that when I have already told you in the previous lectures also, and you must remember, as and when we are moving from lower vertebrates to higher vertebrates, number of gill slits were reducing, and gills are the primarily structures of the aquatic animals. When there was a shift during the course of evolution from aquatic animals to terrestrial animals, so it is supposed that most of the gills were closed because gills were not having any more function on the land. So it was the last gill pouch which was about to get away, transform itself into the lungs. Because I have already told you that all the respiratory surfaces must be highly vascularized, must have the rich supply of the blood, so the lungs do have the same. Swim bladder, because we have talked that it is the lungs, they are prominent in the terrestrial aquatic terrestrial vertebrates and the lung fishes. While looking at the lung fishes, there are three lung fishes: African lung fish Protopterus, Australian Neoceratodus, and the American lung fishes, that is Lepidosiren. They don't have the exactly the lung that the vertebrates have, but it is the swim bladder of these fishes which act as a lung. So it's a better lung. Even once the lungs have started developing from the amphibian onwards, in the amphibians the lungs were not so well developed, but it is supposed that the swim bladder of the lung species is much better lung than that of the amphibian lungs. Now these swim bladders, they remain connected with the gut. Lung species basically respire through both, through gills as well as the lungs. And these air bladders, they act as a lung because they are richly vascularized. They have a good supply of the blood inside them. So their surface area is also increased with the development of the alveoli-like structure inside them. So that is why these air bladders are not exactly similar with the rest of the air bladders of the rest of the fishes, which are neither vascularized nor having the alveoli inside them. It is believed that this air bladder allowed the organism to gulp air under oxygen poor condition. So it is supposed that when lung fishes feel that there is a poor oxygen, less oxygen in the environment, or the oxygen taken from the gills is not sufficient to meet the body requirement, then it gulp the air inside, because ultimately these air bladders, they are connected with the gut. So once the air is gulped inside the gut, from the gut it enters into these air sacs, or the swim bladders. These swim bladders then have the rich supply of the blood, so the diffusion of gases takes place over there. Accordingly, if it takes up the oxygen and it removes the waste also, like carbon dioxide. Looking at the lungs of the fish amphibians, they are very simple and they are hollow sac. They are hollow sac with wide central cavity. The central cavity is wide enough and suspended freely into peritoneal cavity. Peritoneal cavity, you know, the cavity which encloses the visceral organs. These lungs are without lobes, they don't have any lobe. Alveoli are few in number and restricted to the anterior portion in most of the cases. So, because the alveoli are few in number, that is why their lumen is wide enough, large enough. Lumen or central cavity of the lung, you can say. Left lung is usually longer in them, you can see in nocturus. In here the left lung is longer, whereas the right one is smaller. No, it is the nocturus which have the smooth inner lining, so they don't have the alveoli, so they have the wide central cavity. Whereas in some others, like you can see over there in siren, it is having the alveoli present in them, as a result of which the cavity, the central cavity of the lung is little bit reduced, but it is at the anterior end only. Posteriorly, the lungs are again having the wide cavity. In case of the frogs, you can see that the frogs do have the these alveoli present on whole of the surface of the lungs. So, alveoli basically the folding of the lung wall in order to increase the surface area for absorption of the oxygen and for diffusing out the carbon dioxide. Coming to the reptiles, lungs of reptiles are thin, walled, elongated, you can see, and fusiform. That means they have both the ends tapering. You can see this end at this end, both the ends are tapering. They are elastic and hollow sacs lying in thoracic cavity inside the peritoneum. They are without lobes. Again, they don't have any lobe like the amphibians. They are more complicated as compared to the amphibian because they have developed the folding of the inner wall along whole of the length of the lung. As a result, their central body cavity is much smaller and is occupied by the alveoli. In legless lizards like gnatrix and snakes, left lung may be rudimentary or absent. So, they have only the, you can see the left lung is rudimentary or absent, only the right lung is present over there. In some other snakes like boa and python, both the lungs are present, but they are smaller in size. In lizards and turtles, wall of the lung is very considerably thickened by developing the well folding of the inner wall in order to increase the surface area. So, they have very much reduced central cavity in the lung. And because of the thickening of this wall, these lungs have become spongy now. Then the crocodilian lungs resemble more with the mammals as compared to the reptiles in the structure. And what is the similarity? What are the mammalian lungs? How they look like? We shall see in the next slide. Now, reptilian lungs also hang freely in the body cavity, and at the posterior end of the lungs, they have a thin walled sac like diverticula called the air sacs that extend from the distal portion of the lung. So, these air sacs can take the air inside them and can swell the abdomen of the these reptiles. So, this swelling of the abdomen helps in frightening the predator so that they can escape. This is the feature of the chameleon. Now, look at the avian lungs. Avian lung is an adaptation to the aerial mode of life. You must remember that birds, in order to fly in the air, have developed so many structures inside their body which are adaptations to the flight mode. That is, they have taken every step in order to reduce the weight of the body so that they can fly easily. And they have taken various steps in order to have more air inside their body so that their body become lighter. Now, a unique structure and mechanism is present in the lungs of the aves, which is basically an adaptation of the avian flight or the aerial mode of the life. And these lungs are supposed to be more efficient as compared to the mammalian lungs. These lungs, if you look at, these are the only lungs present in case of the birds. Very small, they are very compact, spongy, well vascularized with the blood, but they are inelastic. They cannot stretch at their own. They are inelastic, but they have around these lungs, they have 9 air sacs present. These air sacs are very thin walled. They are non-vascularized, and they are very light in weight. They are not spongy. So these air sacs basically expand and contract, causing the air to come inside from the trachea into the lungs, then to themselves in the air sacs, and then after contacting it, expel out the air through the lungs. So in this way, you can see that air is continuously coming through the lungs, passing to the air sacs, and then from the air sacs crossing through the lungs to the trachea. These air sacs are sometimes continuous with the you can see the cavity of the bone inside the birds, the pneumatic cavity. So they are basically increasing the pneumatization. That is, because the air sacs are present, which are larger in size as compared to the lungs, so they are light in weight, and they have the air, and this air, like the clavicular air sac, is continuous with the air sac of the humerus bone. So again, this air cavity present inside the bone is again of the birds, is again in order to lighten the weight of the birds. So again, all this is the adaptation for the flight. So air sacs with a thin wall helps in increasing the pneumatization, that is presence of air in the body, and thereby it is increasing very efficient respiration, but without putting much weight to the body. So if the lungs were having large size, then what will, because the lungs are spongy, they have a well thick wall, the weight of the lungs must be would have increased. As a result, it would have been become difficult for the bird to fly. So they have reduced their size of the lungs, but they have developed the air sacs, which are very thin walled. They are not spongy at all. Because these lungs, they are inelastic, so they remain constant in volume of the volume present inside them. So their volume cannot be increased or decreased during the respiration. They are placed in the pleural cavity. These lungs are placed in the pleural cavity, and these lungs are firmly attached to the dorsal thoracic wall of the birds. Air sacs often remain connected to the pneumatic cavity, I have already told you. Then the bronchus, after entering the lung, divides repeatedly to form the anastomosing capillaries. Anastomosing capillaries means when two different ends are joined together by so many branches without having a blind end. So there is no air sac or alveoli like structure present over there, because alveoli are the blind sac from which no further extension of the cavity is there. But here air is coming from, say for example, from this side, and is entering to this side, thus emptying it as a whole. So it don't have the air alveoli like structure. they don't have blind terminals. Like this is the blind terminal if you look at. Say for example, if air will come to this side, it will not cross this. So some of the air will remain there as a residual air. But these air capillaries, they are having the opposite end open to the another tube. So this is the anastomosing type of structure. This has further increased the efficiency of respiration. That because this is the area for the respiration inside the lungs, so what will happen, that whole of the air will cross from this side to this side and from this side to this side. As a result, no residual air will remain inside the lungs. So this has increased the respiration or the respiratory efficiency. Ear sacs, they remain connected with the end of the main bronchial branches. So this is the main bronchial branches. So every air sac is connected within the lungs with this main branch. Air sacs are necessary respiratory organs. So they are accessory respiratory organs, because main respiration takes place in the air capillaries present within the lungs, but they are accessory as they act as a balloon or bulb to suck the air inside and then push the air through the lungs to the outside. So they are the reservoir, you can say. Now you look at the mammalian lungs. Mammalian lungs are highly developed. They are large enough, they are soft, they are spongy and very elastic. They can contract and relax as well. They lie protected in a special chamber called pleural cavity, surrounded by peritoneum. Peritoneum is the lining of the coelom, because it is the coelom which harbors many visceral organs present inside them. So again, lungs are again protected over by coelom, which are separated from the perivisceral body cavity by a muscular diaphragm. So there is you have a muscular diaphragm below them, which separate them from the abdominal cavity, you can say. In most mammals, lungs are subdivided externally into lobes. Like you can see in the human being, you are having the left lung divided into two lobes, inferior and the upper superior lobe, and then the right lung divided into three lobes, superior, middle, inferior. And likewise, in case of the rabbit, you have that four lobes only. In some mammals, such as whales, sirenians, elephant, herrix, and many perissodactyl, lungs are simple without any lobes. In monotremes, egg-laying mammals, and the rats, only right lung is lobulated, whereas the left lung don't have any lobe present. The mammalian lung consists of an elaborate branched respiratory tree, you can see. It is exactly like a tree. Like this is the trunk of the tree, then the trunk is dividing repeatedly in order to give rise to many branches. So it is exactly like a tree, so it is called the respiratory tree, because it is present inside the lung. The bronchus, the trachea, first of all, is coming and then dividing itself into many bronchus. The bronch then divide repeatedly, ultimately giving rise to the blind sacs present at the periphery. They are very minute, which are called the air sacs or the alveoli. These are the alveoli which are highly vascular, so they take the oxygen, they give the oxygen to the blood supply present in them and take the carbon dioxide from them for the exhalation. This trachea then divides into small branches called the bronchi. Then bronchi divides repeatedly to form the bronchioles, and then bronchioles divide repeatedly to form the air sacs, which are having a very rich supply of the blood on their outer side. Because their air sacs are terminal in position, so it is not like the capillaries of the birds you have seen. So always during every respiration, after every breathing, some amount of the air may remain inside them, which is called the residual air. in order to bring out the respiration, in order to contract and relax the lungs, which are, because they are elastic, the ribs, the intercostal muscle, the muscle present between the ribs and the ribs themselves, along with the diaphragm present below the lungs and the sternum of the thoracic cavity and the abdominal muscles, all they help, they work together in a coordinated manner in order to bring out the respiration or the breathing, you can say. Thanks. This is all about the comparative account of the lungs in the vertebrates.